once I was checking a bag, and the guy by the counter, he sees my ticket says Nathan, the license says Nathaniel, and he was like, this is not good. He goes, these names don't match. And I was like, but they match, right? Like, you can see the leap that we took to get from one to the other. And he's like, but they're not the same. I was like, but they're the same. And I'm realizing he cannot find out people call me Nate at that point because, I mean, he can't handle that. He's going to call the police over to be like, there's a guy with three names trying to fly right here. If you guys want to just shoot him from over there or something. So I was like, what do you want me to do? And he goes, you should go home. That's all I got. He's like, I can't believe you've made it this far. I was like, let me just try it, you know? Shouldn't I try it? I said, look, I'll give you that those names don't match. But what I think is going to help a ton is the picture on the ID. Something that I've always loved that they did. And I think with 70% of that name matching and 100% face, it's 170%. I think I'll get through. And this is what he told me. This is honestly what he said. He goes, look, man, I get it, all right? He's trying to relate to me. And he was like, my name's Joseph. That's what's on my license. So I can't buy a ticket under my nickname Bart. They're not gonna let me through. And he said it like, right? Like, do you know what, does that make sense? And I was like, that doesn't at all. Those are two different names, all right? I should be over there and you should be over here because that's how you're treating me. Like I'm a Joseph Bart.
Been on the road a lot, been traveling every week. I was going through security recently at the airport in New York and they have a giant sign as you're going through security that just said 9/11, never forget. And I was like, I can't forget before I board the flight. You can't give me 3.5-4 hours of maybe blocking that one out? We're like one step away from the pilot coming on. Hey, this is your captain. It could happen again, guys. We're due. Keep your head in a swivel, because I've got a bad feeling about today for some reason.
Travel a lot. I'm constantly going through security, always behind that person that's never left their house before. They always want to ask me questions. They're like, can I bring soup on the plane? It's homemade soup. I'm like, you should ask them. For an ID, can I use a fishing license? Should I take off my shoes and my pants? Yes, you should. Airport security is annoying. It's nothing compared to international travel, like going through customs and immigration. That's so intense. They're dressed like SWAT team members. I always get so nervous. I'm like, do I have heroin on me? I don't even know what heroin looks like, but I might have accidentally packed some. There's that mini interview with the customs agent. What do you plan to do in that country? Murder people. You got me. I wasn't ready for your trick questions. I always feel like an idiot when I travel internationally. Some of it is I don't know the metric system. It's not like I wasn't exposed to it. When I was growing up, they're like, learn the metric system. Everyone learn the metric system. Big switch coming up. And then 10 years later, they're like, never mind. It's too hard. It's based on tens. Let's go buy an SUV. So now I can't ask a distance when I visit another country. I'm like, how far is that? They're like, that's 500 kilometers. I'm not in the Olympics. This isn't a James Bond film. What's it in normal speak?
Dave has gotten us to 48 of the 50 states. He doesn't travel with us outside of America. He prefers it that way. Last year, we got a chance to do a European tour of 15 countries. Estonia, Germany, Norway, Belgium, the Netherlands, UK. We're just bouncing around all over the place. And then we wound up on the other side of the world. Out of all the countries I performed in, my favorite country outside of home is Australia. And I'll tell you why. Australia, much like us in America, has its list of priorities. You know what's not on their list? Political correctness. They do not care about your feelings. It's like a country full of Daves. Believe it or not, it's very refreshing to be around such a large group of people who speak their minds so freely. And if you know that before you go there, you're gonna have an amazing time. But if you don't know that and you show up, it is a culture shock and a half, because I showed up and I didn't know. Everybody says, you gotta see the beaches, and I went to the beach. I had people coming up to me. Hey, somebody help me get them back in the water. Yeah, look right there, big fella. Look at you right there. Yeah. Oh, look, he's moving. Oh, he's crying. I bet it tastes like gravy.
I feel like a good country song can have you reminiscent about times you never had. Like, we weren't like a lake family growing up. My family, we never went to the lake. But I hear a country song about the lake, I'm like, yeah, I remember that. It was a good time. And we needed that, because growing up, we never traveled. Like, I grew up in a trailer park in Alabama, and we had a pretty good time, but not sure why they call it a park. You know what I mean? Like, there wasn't no rides in there, no water slides. We had, like, an occasional slip and slide, or, like, an old tarp with some Dawn dish detergent on it. We put our slip and slide over a tree root one time. Yeah, because we was going jumping. And that's not how that works. At all. I hit that tree root, I just got up and got a job. Like, I'm done playing out here. Well, I'm done playing, period. I got medical bills now. I don't know if you've ever hit a tree root going 70 miles an hour on your chest with a smile on your face, but it'll knock that smile off. I never went camping growing up, because like I say, I grew up in a trailer, and we felt like we had a pretty good idea. Camping was all about. We're like, nah, we already kind of live in a camper. We don't really need to take it down to a tent. You know? Like, we know what it's like to be poor. We're not trying to find out what it means to be homeless. Right?
Palm Springs was Caucasian decadence. It was his and hers kitchen sinks. You know what I mean? That kind of a level. And it's funny traveling while black in a place like Palm Springs, because nobody knows how you got there, you know? And you kind of start like a whisper campaign. Walk into the restaurant and they're like, is it Michelle? And it's like, no, it's not, but I will take a free appetizer, you know? Yeah. And we were staying in this hotel where people could bring their dogs, which normally I wouldn't have been into, but something happened to me, y'all. I moved to LA, I felt that hot air on my face, and I was like, I want a dog and a podcast, you know, immediately. And there was this old black lab sitting by the pool, and I love old dogs. Old dogs are my jam, okay? It's so true, right? I don't want that dog that hears the doorbell and starts running in a circle and yapping. I want the dog that hears the doorbell and is like, you gonna get it? You know what I mean? Like, doesn't even lift up. Doesn't rise from the bed. And that was this black lab just chilling, you know? Plus, it's 100 degrees in Palm Springs, so me and this black lab are just two colored girls trying to stay in the shade. We were besties. We made a life together. And after 10 minutes of me petting this dog, two older white women approach, fresh out of a Nancy movie. Okay. They come over because, you know, obviously one of them owns the dog, and they're like, who are you? And they introduce themselves, and their names were Susan and Jan. Oh, Palm Springs, take me away. I love it. And we start chit-chatting, and I'm hoping that Susan and Jan are a couple, but they're just friends, and I'm like, boring, but all right, keep talking. And we're chatting, and Susan and Jan are besties. They are on a vacay, a road trip, and Jan stays with me. She has a place in my heart, you guys, because Jan lived in Maui, Hawaii, and was on vacation in Palm Springs. And yes, honey. And at one point, we chit-chatting, and Jan says to me, dead serious, Well, I know people go to Maui for a vacation, but sometimes I need a vacation from Maui.
What?
Woo-hoo! Y'all, that is the Janest shit I ever heard. I say, Jan, you a bad bitch. Okay. Hey, Jan, I see you talking to me like I'm not black in America. Go on.
I was flying Heathrow to JFK just before Christmas, right? Boarded us early on the plane. She comes round, oh, champagne in a wine glass, like you like it, Mr. Gervais. I go, thank you. She goes off, I go, excuse me, got any of them warm nuts? She went, oh, we're not handing out nuts on this flight. There's a lady getting on who's so allergic that even someone else eating nuts in the vicinity would cause her to have a fatal reaction. I went, oh my God. She went, yeah. I said, oh, of course, yeah. I was fuming. What's that got to do with me? Why can't I eat nuts just because fucking this woman will die, right? Nuts. I mean, how has she lived this long? If walking by a nut kills you, if being just near a nut, how has she never been near a nut before? And how has she lived long enough, having never been near a nut, how has she lived long enough to earn enough money to be near me on a plane?
I'll tell you what should be a crime. People boarding planes while wearing backpacks. If you're someone who does that, a little heads up, your backpacks are hitting people in the face. I don't even care about what's in front of me. Hell with everything in my wake. You know when you sit in the emergency exit row seat and you agree to save everyone? How come when the flight is over, no one thanks you? Seriously. It's amazing what you might have done. You'd think someone would take note of that. Hey, I heard what went down before takeoff. Thank you. The fact that you were willing to put your life on the line to save me, my family, and all the other souls on this plane is nothing short of outstanding. Thank you, thank you, thank you. No, just a backpack to the back of the head. I was an almost responder!
So one time I'm flying into Albany, New York, okay? A city that nobody really goes to, so I'm on a smaller plane, and everything's going great. All of a sudden, out of nowhere, we hit this turbulence, just... right? And it stops, and everybody looks around like laughing nervously, like, oh. Eesh. All of a sudden, it comes back with a vengeance. You can literally hear like the metal the plane's made out of, like. All of a sudden, this dude, like three rows back, starts making like these bitchy noises, like, whoa, 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 whoa. I have never been so fucking scared in my entire life. Dude, that noise is acceptable out of a female or a child. To turn around and see a 37-year-old mustachioed male going, whoa, whoa, whoa. Dude, the hair was standing up on my arms. I'm praying to a higher power. I don't even believe in the shit. I just wish I had the balls to turn around and be like, dude, would you shut the fuck up? Jesus Christ, be a man. Push it down. Push it down. Deny your feelings. Act like you have answers. Do some man shit right now. Do some man shit. Jesus Christ. You know, you think I'm not up here thinking, ooh, ah, I am. But how does that help us for me to join you and turn this fuselage into a haunted house? You know?
Yeah, I've been flying a lot. My flight landed recently and something kind of strange happened. I was coming down the aisle. The pilot was standing at the front. I never know what to say to them afterwards. You know, it's always like, thank you, good game, whatever. And then I muttered something incoherent. I kind of shuffled by. And then I heard the woman behind me and she just leans into him and she goes, I really enjoyed what you did with the flight. Which I thought was strange, but also kind of beautiful, because what I had just thought was like a standard takeoff journey landing, she treated him like he was some kind of experimental performance artist of the air, where she's just like, honestly, what you did up there was groundbreaking work. Like, that safety video was just such a subversive meta-commentary on obedience. And you made me rethink clouds. But, like, I can imagine her not always being as nice. Like, she gets off a different flight and she's just like, okay, wow. That was derivative. It was a lot of the same old ending, you know, super predictable. Like, I hate to say it, but it felt like you were on autopilot the whole time. I know. Oh, sick pilot burn. Not nice.
That same trip coming back from Vancouver was the worst travel experience I've ever had in my life. I'd been on the road for 3 months in a row, 12 weeks, hadn't been home. I was so homesick that I had a 6 p.m. flight. I changed it to 6 a.m. last minute, cost $1,000. I had to bump up to first class. I was like, I don't care. I'm going to do this. I need to get home. I just got to do it. I got to get home 12 hours earlier. So I stay up all night to make sure I don't miss this flight. Get to the airport, it's delayed, right? So now my connecting flight, I only have a half hour to make an international connection, which is usually not enough time, but I was like, nah, fuck that, dude, we're doing this, right? So I'm huffing and puffing through this whole airport. I'm elbowing the elderly out of the way. I'm like, excuse me, sir, I have to be high on my couch. Instead of high right here, right now. I'm doing that embarrassing little roller bag trot. You know, I don't care. I'm getting home. I don't care what the optics are. So I get there. By some miracle, I make it to my gate. 6 minutes to spare. I'm the only one from my flight that made it. I'm feeling so triumphant. I'm out of breath. I go to the girl at the little kiosk. I show her my boarding pass. She's a trainee. Tries to scan it. Can't get it to work. And in my head, I'm like, can't even get a fucking boarding pass to work? Maybe you ain't cut out for Delta, sweetheart. You know?
They got all the security, they take your shoes, they take your shampoo. When did shampoo become so dangerous? They take your shampoo, you get through security, and then they sell shampoo at the gift shop. Sometimes they're trying to sell you your own shampoo back. I know my Prel when I see it. Yo, I'm tired of all the security. Yo, they need an airline for people that don't give a fuck. They need an airline with absolutely no security for people that are in a hurry and willing to take their lives in their own hands. That's what they need. I pay an extra $50 for that shit. They need to call it Risky Airline. Try Risky Airlines, Muslims half price. That's right, the bigger the beard, the more leg room you get. They don't even have tickets. They just stamp your hand like you at a club. You're like, I was in already. At Risky Airlines, all our pilots are bad apples.
It's 2 a.m. She opens the door. I'm higher than Moby Dick. She sees I'm awake, walks up next to my bed and goes, hey, Dad, you believe in time travel? By the way, it's 2 a.m. I'm high as shit, and I really do believe in time travel. Part of me is like, this is the perfect time to have this conversation. Yes, baby, why? She goes, is it possible that I could come back from the future to tell myself a secret? And I'm like, oh, are you fucking, this is how it starts. This is how it starts. I go, yes, baby, why? She goes, that's all I needed to know. Good night. And leaves. Leaves me spiraling. Certain that there's a 30-year-old version of my daughter in her bedroom going, what did he say? Ah, it's good to see you again, Isla. I told you so. listen, we got a busy night. Dad's gonna die, he's had too much marijuana. We're gonna save his life. First, I need you to get your deodorant and put it in the refrigerator. Time travel smells like shit. We're gonna rub it under our noses.